So the last episode ended on incest.
Incest, Utena's favorite thing.
We immediately jump into, oh hey, it's Mickey's sister.
The other incest.
Yeah, you notice a trend here. So what's interesting here is that this is it's not a subtle scene at all. So
there's no subtlety in this episode really at all.
The entire episode, though, the one thing that might have been subtle is that the title was, what exactly did it say? The world seen from Kozue.
So I wonder who's going to go in the elevator in this episode. Could it be the person in the opening scene who's also mentioned in the name of the episode?
But think of it this way. The episode's telling you this is all from Kozue's perspective. So that probably pedophile teacher that was hanging out with Miki, was he really a bad person, or is that Kozue just being crazy? Because we're seeing everything from her perspective. We're not seeing a neutral, nuanced, balanced perspective of the world. This is Kozue's view.
He's just a music teacher.
But Miki sees her, you know, interacting with her latest boyfriend, which, as we learned, is her new boyfriend among many. She added him to her stable. And he gets that same motif, that same note of, oh, I'm weirded out because my sister is doing the thing that I don't like because I actually really like her and have these weird feelings, and it's all triggered all over again.
And Kozue doesn't care. She's like, whatever.
It's not that she doesn't care.
Well,
she wants him to see it. When she notices that he's watching, she dials it up. And she even looks at him.
Oh, baby.
Yeah, oh, you're watching, eh? Well, let me... But then when the pedo teacher is messing with Miki, at least from her perspective, not only does she doesn't just like see it out of the corner of her eye and react to it, she pushes that dude away.
Dosta?
What?
By the face. Mm-hmm. That is how she treats him as an object. Her boyfriend, she does not care at all about that dude.
Nope.
Or any of these dudes. They are just tools, because she says
it
herself.
Just like Toga doesn't care about all these ladies.
Yeah.
Same deal.
In the elevator, when she goes down, she basically says, I hurt myself to hurt Miki. I degrade myself to hurt Miki. And she is doing that here. And then we get that scene where Juri's like, I know that you attacked that other teacher and then threatened them.
先週、あの先生が階段から落ちたのは事故じゃなく誰かが突き落としたって噂だった。
And I know you're attacked. Like, she knows. She knows 100% right. What she's
up to. So everything from the season one, where Kozue and Miki have this relationship, right, is really unchanged, despite
yep.
what happened in the previous episode about this, right? It's pretty much status quo. They're reminding you of it, and they're also telling you that it's going to be the focus of this episode, right, in which it somewhat gets resolved, at least more than the last time.
Yeah. So there's a trend in Black Rose, and all these duels, because obviously, you know, Mikage said, I'm going to go through all the duelists, so there's going to be a duel with Juri's sword, and Toga's sword, and Sionji's sword. It's all mm-hmm. going to happen.
Right.
So every one of those previous arcs, because Sionji has little story arc where then he gets kicked out of school. And Toga has a story arc where now he's sad in a room alone, listening to Symphony from the New World. Perhaps a world after it's revolutionized.
After the end of the old world.
Yeah. G jury had her story arc. Now, all of Black Rose, from this point forward, is round two of every one of those story arcs.
Well, we skipped the Seonji one, at least for now, because he's not in school anymore, yeah. Right? So we had that, you know, previous episode sort of made up for that and also introduced the Black Rose. Now, yep. We're back to that Monster of the Week, Duel of the Week formula. So, of course, Miki, right? We're probably going to get a jury, you know, whatever, coming up next. So, the thing is, they set this up, and basically the... you know, our Black Rose antagonist, right? They have a meeting and they're like, you know, that one didn't really work out. Yeah, you know what, though? It turns out it seems like some young people, right, have strong hearts that they can, you know, they have, you know, free will, basically.
Well, they have strong hearts, but they don't really have the will or the discipline to use them. So he needs a strong heart that could be wielded.
Well, he needs a sword from a strong heart. Yes. It's like, yeah, those student council people all had strong hearts. But they all screwed up. But what if we could get our duelists to use their swords? So let's start looking for someone who can take the sword from a student council.
Well, now there's three components. There's the strong heart, which is represented as a sword in the duel, mm-hmm. But the strong heart needs direction. You need the direction of the previous duelist from the coffin who had the will.
Yep.
And then you need a third element. You need the person who has the pull or the control or the tie to the heart to wield it.
Right, so you need to, you know, you gotta get a sword from one of these real people, one of these student council people with colored hair. You can't get it from one of these side characters,
yep.
Right, who's in one episode and then a fraction of another episode.
And the episode makes a point of even reminding you that, yeah, normal people are not involved in this, normal people don't matter, because the duel is posted next to the final exam schedule, mm-hmm. And you see all the non-colored hair people looking at the schedule being like, oh my god, final exams are so fucking important. But then Utena, with colored hair, looks and sees the duel. The only thing that's her final. Well, I guess it's her midterm.
Yeah. But anyway, so there's some little side bits that happen before we get to the elevator here, right? I mean, most of the episode is just taken up with, like, over half the episode is just set up of, look, Kozue and Miki, remember? Remember?
Yep.
And it's just the same stuff over and over again. The milkshake drinking, the, you know,
yep.
The fighting, you know, Anthy playing the piano, right? And that sets up, you know, Kozue targeting Anthy, and targeting Anthony and wanting to kill her, which is what the Black Rose people need from you to sign you up,
yep.
Right? You know, she's targeting Anthony because Anthony's close to Miki, and just like she targeted the teacher before him.
Interestingly, she didn't know who Anthy was.
And Utena had never met Kozue before.
And Utena mentioned, oh, that's Anthy.
Sokka, kimi ga Kozue-chan nanda. Miki kara kiiteru yo. Ano megane no hito. Nante namae dakke? Himemiya Anshi da kedo. Kanojo ga dou ka...
That happened in season one, where yeah. Nanami was like, who is that?
Right.
Tenjo Utena.
Tenjo Utena?
Ah, because that's
all. But anyway, so little things that happen is we see Toga, finally. He's really sad, all alone, doing
yep.
Nothing.
Listening to Symphony from the New World on right. A loop. And Nanami, when she tries to break through to him again and has kind of given up,
nope.
She's wearing the student council uniform now all the time. Not just the one time she dueled, but she's wearing it full time.
Yeah, and then she goes and runs a student council meeting very, very poorly. And the only people on the student council are Juri and Miki.
Yep, because Sayonji's
gone and Toga's, you know, AWOL.
Yep.
Right? And she's like, she says she gets the thing wrong.
Tamago no kara o yaburaneba. ひなどりは生まれずに死んでいく。自由の部屋と自由の籠、空の広さを教えずに、彼らはひなを可愛がる。世界の籠を破壊せよ。
And Juri's just like, have we gotten letters from End of the World? No, because they're all going to someone else now.
Yep, and so she's got the fan, and there's a bunch of other points in this episode where they remind you it's summer right now. Because when Mickey's having his completely inane...
Why are they drinking milkshakes at night before bed?
Well, that's just because they're weird.
But I'm
Plus,
saying...
Plus, that's not a milkshake, wouldn't... that's just milk. I think that's Japan.
Maybe, but if it was, you know, if it wasn't summer, you wouldn't be drinking milk. You would be drinking something warm, like hot chocolate.
Well, it's milk, it's cold milk, or tea. Obviously.
They're drinking something cold.
So remind, but they make a point of reminding us, hey, it's summer, because when Mickey's having his totally inane, I want to flirt with Anthy, blah, 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 blah conversation, that little chime keeps chiming. And then when they have a student council meeting, the fan is blowing. And Nanami is trying to, like, do the thing and continue the duels and make everything happen. And she's the fan. She's trying to blow. She's trying to change the direction of the wind. But as Juri points out, they're not fans. The student council, they're just pinwheels. They're being blown. And right now, there's no one to blow them. They're idle. Because she's like, well, that's all well and good, but End of the World didn't send us any letters.
The end. Nothing doing here.
Yeah.
Go look elsewhere where the action is.
But we do know the End of the World is at least allowing Mikage and the Black Rose thing to happen. So the End of the World's complicit in all of this and isn't telling them to duel because all those other people are dueling.
Yep. So anyway, we get right on to the duel action, right? First, we get our elevator, Shadow Girls duel, usual setup, which is going to be the setup for a lot of episodes to come. Because obviously, Kozue is the person who's going in the elevator.
Kozue is like butterfly bottom.
Yep.
Immediately.
Because she knows, you know, it's so straightforward what her deal is, and she just comes out with it right away.
In fact, it's very interesting that Nemuro doesn't have to even dig that hard. She knows what her problem is. She, in fact, is probably one of the most self-aware characters in the show. She's like, I degrade myself because I know it makes my brother feel bad. I want him to be close to my heart, blah, blah, blah. It bothers me when other people get close to him. This other girl's getting close to him. I have to stop her.
Yep. Auntie's close to him. I want to stop her. He's like, well, that's what I needed to know. Here you go. Here's your ring.
Yep.
So then the thing is, she goes to get a sword, a strong sword, and she goes to get a sword from Mickey's heart. Dun, dun.
Now, interestingly, Anthy was late to their meeting and Mickey fell asleep. Which set the stage for this to happen. Why was Anthy late? Probably because she's complicit in all of this.
Yeah, normally she would have showed up on time. She showed up late on purpose so that this would happen.
Yeah. In fact, she, to drive Kozue to go to Nemuro, notice how she shows up late before, and she walks in just as Kozue is about to kiss her brother while he's asleep.
Weird.
Yeah.
Awkward.
Meanwhile, we've got a sort of confirmation that Miki, his motivations are actually as pure as they appeared to be in the first season. Because when she tries to kiss him and is sort of edging toward groping him, he is shocked and then jumps away from her like she was a hot iron.
Right, he doesn't like her getting with weird dudes for the same reason that a normal brother doesn't like your sister getting with weird dudes, or, you know, a mom doesn't like their son going with weird girls, or, right? It's like, you don't like anyone that you're close to getting with someone that you don't think is a good person, right?
He really wants her to be that little sister he knew before.
A good person.
And it's very clear when he is asking Anthy out.
A goody-goody person.
He isn't like, hey, let's get together. He's like, hey, that piano teacher would probably be really happy. Piano, piano, piano. He actually wants to play the piano.
Hai. Ganbare, mou hitokoe. Himemiya-san, you got a last on Hokago, is any piano he to Kremasenka? It's no book no ongak no sense any shokai stein this. Himemiya-san no enso kikeba, sense mo zetai odorok to mondes. Dakara, onegaishimas.
Sure.
And it's a very childish desire because much like he makes the milkshake at night for both of them and they're matching little cups and it's so cute. And he drinks his.
He's been doing it for a long time.
He drinks his because he's a child.
Everything they have is matching with the little M and the little K written on. Even the bedposts have it written on there and everything.
But she doesn't drink it because she's like, it's too sweet. I'm not a kid anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And then when they're in the duel, what's on the desk? The thing that symbolizes what they're fighting over? A full glass of milkshake.
Dun dun. Anthy gets some. She's like, oh, yeah. It tastes great. I'll drink this. I don't care.
So Anthy interacts with the elements in Black Rose pretty often.
This isn't just any glass of milkshake. It's the M milkshake. It's Mickey's milkshake. The object of Kozue's desire is Mickey's heart. Mickey's childish heart, epitomized by the childish milkshake he drinks every night. The one that she, paradoxically, refuses. Kozue confuses her yearnings to step back into those childhood days with her brother with desire for her brother. This is a theme in Utena, and we'll see how it plays out three times. As you watch the show, compare the parallel sibling relationships of Miki and Kozue, Anthy and Akio, and Nanami and Toga. All are conflations, and the contrast between them is one of the show's strongest themes.
She set all of this up, and she's drinking the sweet reward of having caused this duel to happen.
Right, and in case you didn't get it during the whole rest of the 20-something minute episode, during the duel, Kozue is just like, destroy the whole world except for me and Miki. I don't care about anything else.
Yeah, what does she exactly say? She wants the whole world to disappear.
Anything can go away except for me and Miki. That's all that matters. Okay. Well,
yep.
We know that already.
But the thing on the desks that symbolizes her desire, she has a deeper rooted desire too to maybe regress to being that child because then she can abdicate her responsibility. Mm-hmm. Because the thing that's on the desk is the full glass of milk that represents her not being a child anymore after she loses the duel and they burn the soul of the person who was inhabiting her body and blah, yada, yada, yada.
The two people.
We'll get to that. Then she actually accepts Mickey's milk and drinks it at the end of the episode, and it's not creepy.
And she also forgets everything.
Yeah, she doesn't remember. She's like, oh, was it really true that I passed out from anemia? And he's like, yeah.
Even though, he doesn't know that she went to a duel, but he knows all the stuff that happened in the room with the piano.
Yeah.
He wasn't in the duel room. He was unconscious because his sword was absent.
So it is interesting, though, that we sort of get this confirmation that Miki's desires are surprisingly pure and that Miki is, in fact, Milhouse.
I mean, this came out after The Simpsons came out, and he has blue hair, and he acts like Milhouse.
He is Milhouse. So in the Blu-ray, as we talked about in the last episode, they added stuff, and what they added here is that there are two people in that coffin.
Right, so they found someone who matched well with Kozue to steal a black ring from, right? And obviously it was a person who had a relationship such that the two of them were so close that they were in the coffin together.
It's two boys in the coffin holding hands, which is interesting.
Right, so that's, whoever they were, they probably maybe they were brothers, right? Maybe they match really well with Kozue, so that's who they took the ring from.
So step back a little bit, independent of that.
So now we're down to 97, because we started with 100 and we minus 3.
We're getting into this theme of history keeps repeating itself. Because now we're doing all the duels from season one again, but crooked slightly so. The duels are caused by duelists who, in a past age before the show, did these duels before and failed, and now they're getting their second chance. So the show is a cycle, and we're repeating ourselves again. And guess what? In the third season of the show,
we repeat it one more time.
We're going to go through one duel as each one of these arcs achieves its conclusion.
Mm-hmm. All right, so really, this episode doesn't have too much going on besides that, except for the creepy moon.
Yeah, so Akio mentions the moon.
お兄さんってどういう存在なんですか?何です?お月様?普段は気にもしないし役にも立たない。でも時々見上げたりして心安らかになったりする。
Kind of out of nowhere. He just pushes his picture
over. So the majority of the episode is this Kozue thing, but then there's just tiny little scenes like the one with, the student council and whatnot. So there's a tiny scene. Utena goes to meet Akio again, just because they do, I guess. Yep. They just meet now, right? So she just meets him for like a few seconds, all we see. And he's like, check out the slide of the moon, right? The moon is really, you forget about the moon. What did he say? I forgot exactly what he said.
You don't even think about it. You never think about it, but it's always there.
Yeah, and then you look up at it and remember it, right? So what is he alluding to there, right? I mean, what does that do with the relationship between Kozue and Miki? Because they're not, you don't think about it. They're thinking about each other all the time.
Well, at the end of the episode, Utena, by herself, after this, muses on what Akio said. And you'll see that a lot. Akio is going out of his way to get Utena to think about the things that he says, to think about him, and it's not obvious where it's going, but it's going somewhere at this point, because he's done that before. He takes an sort of unexpected interest in Utena, which could be considered naive or coincidental, except that we know it's obvious he's the end of the world.
Yep.
That was a heavily, like, we know that already. So the fact that he is saying these things to Utena, and he knows that she's a duelist, but she doesn't know that he knows, means that he has a game, he has an angle too. Mm. So what are the things in the show, or at least in this episode, that are there? The elements that recur episode after episode after episode, to the point that you're comfortable with them, you know they're there, and you don't really put much thought into why they're there anymore. Mm-hmm. Like her going up those stairs, the fact that they have a duel, those bells ring, this giant projector that they're hanging around all the
time. There are a lot of things in the show that are a lot like the moon. Anyway, so the two last tiny bits to wrap, well, three last tiny bits to wrap up this episode, maybe. So you got Shadow Girls.
Yep.
What did the Shadow Girls do? They were on a train, and someone was walking up and down the train selling.
Hey, buy something, won't you?
And one person was all alone in a car, and she goes, oh, shut up. I'm not buying anything. Stop coming in and yelling at me to buy stuff. And then Utena's like, so just ignore her. And eventually she gives in and buys stuff.
Yep. So Shadow
Girls.
The
exact opposite of Utena's sensible advice.
They don't listen to Utena's advice. It might be implied that the person protested a lot, but they actually wanted the goods.
Yep, and they're just like, stop tempting me with the goods. I don't want the goods. All right, I'll take the goods.
Yep. So that almost, if you read that as being relevant to the Miki Kozue story.
Milkshake, get your milkshake. Yeah. I don't want a milkshake, shut up.
Either you could read it as Kozue has these kind of sexual and complicated messed up desires, but like the end of the episode, maybe deep down, she didn't understand herself as well as she thought, and maybe she really did want that milkshake. Or maybe Miki seems to have this very pure motivation, but deep down, actually, he has a very complicated and problematic motivation. You could use it to either make the story one step better or one step worse.
All right, so two other little tiny things. Number one, in the duel, right, Kozue is using Mickey's sword. So she fights like Miki. They animate her the same way that Miki fought. Remember, Miki was awesome at fencing.
Yep, and she's right? Dangerous.
Right? Like, other than Juri and Miki, they were pretty much like the masters of fencing, and Toga and Sionji were the masters of kendo, right? So Miki was ridiculously awesome at fencing. Kozue has all of Mickey's fencing powers and his sword, yep. Right? Super strong. Utena's having trouble beating ridiculously strong sword fighting of Mickey's style, right? So what does she do? Anthy's like, oh, Utena, come here. Let's up the power so we can be sure we're going to win this one.
Yeah, cast
right?
The buff. We learned about Utena learned about the buff when Toga used it at the end of last season.
Right.
But pay attention to this episode when that happens, because when Utena first draws the sword out of Anthy, you see a reflection of Anthy's face in the sword. And it's been implied that when they use that power, Anthy's soul inhabits the sword.
The same way as when, you know, Kozue took Mickey's sword, right?
So look at all the reflections of people's faces in swords. Because now we have a person wielding a person they are close to as a literal sword, fighting a person who is wielding a person they are close to literally as a sword.
So the Anthy sword and the Miki sword are going ding, 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 which is what Miki wants. But anyway, so yeah, she uses the buff power that she didn't use before, which shows that the Black Rose plan is actually a good plan. They're getting better at trying to win the duels. They're just still not quite there yet. But Utena had to use the super buff sword power in addition to the power of Dios to have a chance.
Yep. Right. So now too, with it, because we see that the milk on the table, because we knew Miki and we had those scenes, so we had some context to understand that the thing on the desk is relevant to the central conflict of the duel. Mm-hmm. So then if we go back to the last episode with Kanai, it was flowers. And if you look at her sword, it kind of has a similar design to those flowers on the sword, because it's just her own heart. Mm-hmm. So what did those flowers represent from Kanai, who we know nothing about?
They were flowers that she had earlier in the episode. That's about it.
I think the flowers represent her engagement and her ideal life.
Maybe.
And how she realizes in her heart that it's not ideal, that something's wrong, but she can't quite figure it out.
On one hand, these are wedding flowers, and we know that Kanai's marriage to Akio is a cornerstone of her new life, and that her desire to deal with Anthy in some fashion is really the only nettle in that marriage that's coming to be. But in Japan, a vase of flowers on a student's desk is traditionally only done if they've died.
Yeah, well, using someone else's sword is also apparently way stronger than using your own.
Well, because it is a very strong
sword. Especially if it's Mickey's sword. That's Way's power sword.
Yeah, because we know Miki was good enough to be a duelist in his own right before the show started. Right.
And as, you know, the last episode ended with incest, this one began with incest and ended with incest.
Yeah.
But this time, the incest, if you case you missed it in the previous episode, they creep it up times 10 just in case you missed it.
Oi de.
Choo-choo.
I remember when we watched the fan sub of this
after
at RIT.
In the earlier part of the episode, there's a discussion about choo-choo versus choo-choo.
I love how they're saying it the exact same way. Is it choo-choo or choo-choo?
Right. It's like, why? I can't tell what the difference is.
Yeah.
Choo-choo じゃなくて choo-choo다요. Choo-choo じゃまるでネズミじゃないか.
But then at the end,
choo-choo is the sound a mouse makes. His name is choo-choo. It's not choo-choo.
But when we watched the fan sub and we saw that episode for the first time, when we heard that, the whole room was like, what? Like, it feels dirty. It feels
so dirty.
Corrupted. And it is. And you see this. Watch these episodes. You see this sort of daylight view where Akio is perfectly charming. There is no fault to anything he says. He's nice. He's hospitable.
He's just showing you he's a nerd about stars. And yeah. He's like, hey, check out the slide of the moon. Don't you just love planetariums?
He's genuinely interested. He asks Utena questions. If you just saw those scenes and you didn't see the end of season one, you would literally have no reason to suspect that he's up to anything at all.
Except for the fact that the whole show makes you suspect everyone's up to something.
Yeah, but Black Rose shows you that duality. It shows Akio being a complete piece of shit who is obviously evil, and then it shows him being a perfectly wonderful gentleman. Mm-hmm. Completely separate identities.
Well, I mean, is it really evil to have incest? Yeah, okay, it is.
Well, it is implied.
Is it really evil to manipulate everyone into having all these duels and killing 100 people and all this? Yeah, okay, it is. Yeah.
It is implied that there is a power differential as well between Akio and his sister. She is going to him. It is a bad situation. But you see this duality in Akio openly. The show does not hide it. You know he's a piece of shit. But it only shows you on the surface Anthy still being Anthy. You read into and see how sinister she's acting, but it's all told through the fringes. It doesn't actually show you show, it doesn't show you her actively making these things happen.
Right, it doesn't show like a conversation between Akio and Anthy being like, all right, look,
yeah,
Kozue is totally wants Miki, right? And they got this situation, and Mikage, he's thinking about, or was that, right? He's thinking about setting up this plan. He wants to use, right, Mickey's sword. So you're going to show up late to the meeting, right? And make sure that, right? That happened, I guess, but you never see that part. Right, which is why that's the inferred part that's hard to figure out. But that totally happened.
Yeah.
Right? Probably after they were done with their incest.
And it's made very obvious by the fact that you see the duality in Akio, and you only see half of the story in Anthy, so you have to read between the lines there. And the show does the equivalent of, oh, it's you see John Wilkes Booth with a gun, and then you see John Wilkes Booth with the gun walking out of the theater, and then you hear in the distance, Lincoln got shot. It doesn't actually show John Wilkes Booth shooting him, but you know it was John Wilkes Booth. You know it's Anthy.
But maybe that was just, you know, because it's meta, right? You're watching a movie or a TV show, right?
Yep.
If someone shoots a movie, and in the movie you see someone with a gun, and then you see, here's someone dying, you see the person with the gun walking out, you'll think, on the one hand, aha, that person murdered that person. On the other hand, you think, aha, they didn't show the person doing it, it could have been someone else, and it's a mystery, it's going to actually be someone else in the end.
Which, you know, it could be. All right. We don't really know, but the show is setting us up to not trust Anthy at all, and it is doubling down on that. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, Mikage, I mean, if Miki did a decent job of almost beating Utena, like she had to use the power, the toga duel is going to be pretty dangerous, I think.
Yeah, if someone gets Toga's sword out of him while he's sleeping or something, right?
So,
maybe Nanami will get it out of there.
Well, as you're watching the rest of the show now...
She's president of the student council now,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, think real hard about who's going to take the sword out of different people. Because
mm-hmm.
that's a real interesting...
And, you know, you got 13 episodes to work with, right? Well, you got Juri, you got Nanami, you got Toga, Sionji, right? That's a lot less than... 11.
Yep.
You're going to have to get these swords from somewhere. Where are they coming from?
The other ones won't move as quick either. This one was special because Kozue was so self-aware except for that one blind
spot. They had to
spot.
Even stretch it out to fill up the episode, right? They had to stretch it out. So the other ones, they won't have to stretch out as much. There's a lot more going on.